Hey, it's Thomas Porter, and I'm here chatting with Milky. Thought you were someone who could make things so clear. Did I ever know you? Did I just choose what to hear? There's a version in my head that's just disappeared. When I was like 7, I had like mildly pushy parents, mainly my mom. So I was made to learn saxophone. And then from there, like I had just a deep disdain for playing and learning music. But I think by the time I was like 14, 15, I'd like come around to it. And I wanted to start a band, but I had no friends. So I got into music production, which like I'm glad I did now. But at the time it was very kind of like depressing. But yeah, I just kind of sat at home for years and just made beats on my computer. I used to make like dance music. And then I dropped out of uni when I was 19 and like just started pursuing it. Yeah, look, it was a rough few years. But we're doing okay now. And yeah, it's been a wild journey. And I'm so grateful for everything that's happened in the last like year or two, COVID notwithstanding. The way that I like to describe it is, I think everyone has this moment when they're growing up or they're like, especially going through relationships for the first time where you go, oh no, I'm the problem, aren't I? And I think that was this realization, and I'd kind of been on the back of like just a few failed relationships that I'd taken the end of really quite badly. I had like was obviously like quite unhappy with that. And then on reflection, I realized, wow, these are all my fault. Everything ending is just my fault. And I think it was the first time in my life as like an adult that I was able to be like, oh wow, yeah, maybe my actions are actually hurting people a lot more than I'm realizing. And I think this is one lens to look at it through. It's just relationships. I want to do tons of stuff like this where it's like, because I think that growing up, we're all growing up very fast and very flawed. And so yeah, this is just like through the lens of like our romantic relationships, but it's a whole can of pickles, whole can of jalapenos that I won't open. So it started off, I think, wasn't intending for it to be a body of work. I think I'd gotten obsessed with like ukulele and like very simple like hip hop drums in songs. And I don't know how much lo-fi you guys listen to, but there's this whole wave of lo-fi hip hop where it's just like ukulele and like very like, and it's just very chill. And I was like, well, why don't we do that, but like just a bit poppier. And now it's like this whole thing where you've got like number one hits being made that style, like
don't stay away for too long,
that kind of thing. And that's kind of where it started. And it got out of hand, and then suddenly there was an EP, and now it's out in the world and I'm stuck with it. The benefits are, one, it's so cheap. It's so easy to do. I think the hardest bit about being a musician in like this current era is that Ableton and all the like music making software is so accessible that you kind of need to do it. Otherwise, you're going to be paying just such a large amount of money to get producers and mixing engineers and mastering. And so being able to like cut out all that, such a nice bit. And then also just being able to like tell people, no, I don't want to change something because it's exactly what I want it to be. And I had that a few times with this EP where there were a few moments that have turned out to be like perfect. And like I got a bit of pushback, or a lot of the feedback I got was like, are you sure you want ukulele to be like the main thing? And I was like, yes I do. And so yeah, I just like being a producer. It's the best. So I wrote this EP during the first lockdown, and I just had so much time and such a great opportunity to experiment and to like just spend time working on what I wanted something to feel like. Not even in the sense of a project, but just like, oh man, what if I like mess around with you? What if I just made a bunch of drum kits, put them together? Then I was like, well, I've got this really nice uke that I'd bought a few weeks prior, used that. And yeah, and it just kind of, it happens very naturally. I find that when you do try to force a sound, it can be very clunky because it's not natural. And I just got very lucky that this sounded kind of natural, I guess, or as natural as it can. So I'm gonna out myself here. I'm not a visual person. I have no ability to like visualize things. I had this conversation with my partner the other day. We were at home and she's like, can you like picture the living room like looking like this? I'm like, no. I have no ability visually. Miranda Crossley, shout outs. I love you. She has helped me so much, just kind of bring a lot of these ideas to life. And then all the videographers I've worked with, Josh Provost, like so many amazing people have helped me kind of bring a lot of these ideas to life. And now it's kind of seeing where I've got these amazingly talented people to like lean on and bounce off, because I am just awful at it. That's really hard, because I think that the two favorite songs off the EP are probably very polarizing, and like I show them to my friends and the people who I'm like friends with, and they're like, this is so cringe, Charlie. And so like I think a lot of my music has like cringeworthy factor, but if I had to pick one, it'd probably be BLUEBLUE, just because I think it's got a bit more of a vibe to it, and it's just cute, you know, like everyone wants to act cool, but sometimes you just need some cute music, you know, bit of love, bit of cuteness. I think that the one that I love the most, it's at the very end of the EP, it's Nothing's Ever Perfect, Nothing's Ever Great, I fuck it up on purpose and say it's a mistake. I look at music, at least in terms of like writing for other people and writing for myself, as a trend, or like a day job, and it's something that you just kind of get good at, and once you're good at it, and once you have learned what works and what doesn't, or kind of tricks to make things work in your own style, you just do it. And I think that while there are so many musicians who like have a process that is very kind of like experimental and sit back and like really try to make something special, while everything I try to make is special, it's not what I'm saying. I think it's just a matter of just going, and you just make the song, because I always say that what's better than a half done song that could be really good is a finished song that is okay. I've gone into too many songwriting sessions and production sessions where everyone's just trying to make something perfect instead of just making the thing exist. And so that's my approach. I'm just a tradie who presses buttons on a computer. Say it's a mistake. Sitting in my living room, missing someone I never knew. Madion, and then probably in terms of songwriting, Foster the People and Mark Foster. Just that was the first album I bought with my own money, Torches, and I think looking back on that, I think it's so ahead of its time, and I still think that it's a better album than most of like the stuff that's like coming out at the moment, just in terms of like sonic clarity. The production's just insane. Am I allowed to say Mark Foster again? Just for my mum, The Cat Empire, because my mum loves them. That's like our family's only like overlap where we all enjoy a few of the songs. And I think if I ever got to work with anyone from The Cat Empire, I think that there would be like just a meltdown. It's like, Ollie McGill, DM me. You know, I'm sure you know who I am, right? Right? I'd have to say Torches by Foster the People again. Just such a maximalist way of approaching an album. And I think that and 808 and Heartbreaks by Kanye, regardless of what we think of the man right now, I'm gonna go with Slumber by Laura. Oh, I went to Pink when I was 10. Sid Swindale. Spice Girls just have so much more swag. Gassy Spice, I fart a lot. I stand by, like, I'm a big, like, nothing should be guilty, but I listen to a good amount of jazz because I'm a saxophone player. Again, like, I'm not a fan of the guy, but Kanye. Really, really, really drunk. Be patient. It's not all going to happen at once. Like, especially like in the music industry, anything that goes up fast comes down even quicker. And so you've got to be patient. You've got to take things slow. Otherwise, it's not sustainable. When I was like 15 and learning to produce,